The writers of the standard said they received 10,000 public comments. They published 24 of them. That's less than 1/4 of 1%. And not surprisingly, all 24 were positive. They didn't mention that they received a statement signed by more than 500 early childhood professionals opposing the K-3 standards. The statement said, "We have grave concerns about the core standards for young children. The proposed standards conflict with compelling new research in cognitive science, in neuroscience, in child development, and in early childhood education about how young children learn, about what they need to learn, and about how to teach them in kindergarten and the early grades." That statement was signed by the three past presidents of the National Association for the Education of Young Children, which is considered one of the foremost professional organizations in early education, as well as 500 other educators, pediatricians, child development specialists, psychologists, and 11 copies of it were hand-delivered to the writers of the Common Core State Standards. They were ignored. And when the standards were finally written, Dr. Carla Horwitz of the Yale Child Study Center said many of the most experienced teachers of young children are just giving up. They're leaving, she said, because they can't do what they know will ensure learning. The Common Core State Standards will cause suffering, not learning, for many, many young children. Now, remember we talked about there was the marketing side and achieve in conjunction with the National Governors Association and the Council of Chief State School Officers, developed the standards and then marketed them to the state saying, if you sign this memorandum of understanding, you'll be eligible for federal money. Well, what federal money were they talking about? It is now 2009. Mr. Obama is president. And as part of the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act, there was a $53.6 billion appropriation made to the U.S. Department of Education. It was called the State Fiscal Stabilization Fund. Race to the Top was a piece of that fund. In order to get it, the states had to say that they were moving toward the adoption of rigorous, there's the word, college and career-ready standards, and that they would establish a pre-K to college and career data system. So this is not a K-12 transcript record. This is a cradle to workforce data system that tracks our children at the individual level. The states, as part of their package to get the money, had to sign what was called an assurances page. And part of the assurance was that they would establish this longitudinal data system and that it would include all of the elements described in federal legislation called the America Competes Act. This is the workshop that the federal government held on how to do the statewide longitudinal data system. The feds told the states the system had to connect early childhood, college, and labor data. So it's not just K-12 now, it's cradle to career. It had to connect teachers and students, so now we'll be tracking teachers at the individual level. It had to make the data available to researchers and to public stakeholders. Public stakeholders, as defined by the new regulations surrounding the Federal Education Rights and Privacy Act, included anyone with what was called a legitimate educational interest in the schools, including vendors. How did we know? They filled out a form and submitted it claiming that they had that interest, and that was all they had to do. The data had to be able to cross state lines, meaning every state had to use the same codes for every piece of the data system. So there's really only one data system with one set of codes, or it won't be able to cross state lines. And the data had to be useful at every level. What was in the data system? There were 12 elements. Number 1 and number 7, enrollment information and transcript information, sound innocuous until you think about all the things you tell the school when you enroll your child. You give them your health records. You may give them financial records to support free and reduced lunches. Transcript information, disciplinary records, extracurricular activities, any impressions, anything the teachers wrote. Interestingly, if your child runs afoul of the criminal justice system, their criminal record is sealed when they're 18. But if they happened to do that crime in the school, it becomes part of their school transcript information and follows them forever. So our students don't have the same privacy rights as felons. There's an identifier for every teacher State assessment scores are continued. The ability has to be able to be shared from preschool through college, so everyone is using the same system with the same codes and the same numbers so that we can share the data straight through, and every child has an identification number that will follow him or her throughout their process in this system. It was called a P through 20 system, P being preschool, K through 12 being what you think. 13, 14, 15, 16 was college, 17, 18, 19, 20 was the workforce. It started, this system started in 06, 07 with a K through 12, moved in 2009 to include post-secondary, early education, and collecting data on teachers. And then with the stimulus bill, the ARRA funding, you see it has added data on labor, that's when you move into the workforce, your financial records, your health records, and it has to be able to cross state lines. So it really is a system that follows you through your entire life. New York received $3 billion from you were to extend the data system to include student-teacher matching and all of the new data elements that are now being mandated. You were going to create the foundation for the P through 20 system, including outreach to other state agencies which house your workforce data, your health data, and social service data. If you've ever been involved with a mental health or a child protective services, that's social services. So the data system is now going to have multiple agencies all putting in to create a complete dossier on your child and your family. It has to be able to support research, and you have to be able to track student progress over time, including post-secondary, the workforce, and the armed forces. Your grant application talked about how you were doing the linkages, including, and it lists them, the Office of Child and Family Services, the Department of Labor, the Department of Health, the Department of Mental Health, and the Office of Criminal Justice Services to identify opportunities for data links and exchanges. You also said that you would make the data available to researchers. And the way they would do that is they would take the student identification number off and they would give them a new temporary identifier to protect the privacy of the students. But the researchers will get the child's birth date and address and school and teacher. How is that protecting the privacy of the student? With that information, anyone can be found. You didn't just do the data system. You made progress toward implementing these content and achievement standards. And they were also mandated by the America Competes Act. So we have multiple pieces of federal legislation underneath what the marketing says is voluntary. In fact, it wasn't voluntary at all. The U.S. Department of Education again held training sessions for the state on how to move toward adopting these standards. The first one talked about how this is an expansion of the government's role in education, not just K through 12, but now it's cradle to career. So the ARC is now reaching into the homes of preschool students and tracking kids all the way into the workforce. And how do we do that? Well, you must adopt the standards, and the states were told they could either join one of two testing consortia or they could develop their own assessments. But if they developed their own assessments, they had to submit them to the federal government for approval before they could use them. So the federal government is controlling the standards, and the federal government is controlling the assessments. And in the marketing, what you hear is, these are just standards. They have nothing to do with curriculum. That is educational poppycock. Standards that don't have aligned curriculum and aligned assessments are not worth the paper that they're written on. If I control the standard and the test, of course I control the curriculum. Let's look at an example. The standard is you have to make a chocolate cake that tastes just like my chocolate cake and has the same texture as my chocolate cake. And the assessment is I'm coming to taste your cake. How many recipes can there be? One. Because if you change anything in the recipe, your cake will not taste like mine. So if I control the standards and I control the assessments, of course, I control the curriculum. And the federal government told the states this all the way back in 2009, saying, yeah, you must align your instruction so that you can pass the test that we're approving to meet the standards that we control. The connection was called a carrot and a stick. They basically, the feds put the states in a box. First, there was the stabilization money. If you move toward the data system, and then you complied with all of moving toward this, the standards and assessments, you were eligible to apply for Race to the Top funding. It was a competition. In every grant application for Race to the Top funding, the states had to promise that they would adopt the Common Core standards in order to get the money. So the Race to the Top money was the carrot. Adopt the Common Core standards and you get a reward. At the same time, the Elementary and Secondary Education Act authorization, No Child Left Behind, was moving rapidly toward the 2014 100% proficiency deadline. And states were saying, that's impossible. We can't do it. Even with manipulating the tests, 100% of our children are never going to be proficient in reading and math, which, of course, is just a statement of reality. So they went to the feds and said, well, we need a waiver. We need some other way to meet the law so we don't get punished because we can't do the impossible. And the feds said, okay, if you want flexibility, you have to adopt the Common Core state standards. So the flexibility, the No Child Left Behind deadline was the stick. Did the feds know it? Oh, absolutely. Education Week actually ran an article in 2011 where the U.S. Secretary of Education, Mr. Duncan, said, yeah, the states are asking for waivers and we'll give them an option if they do everything we tell them to do. The waiver will have strings attached. We're going to require the states to adopt our education priorities if they want regulatory relief. This is not voluntary. This has been mandatory from the very beginning. You could volunteer to do the mandatory thing. This is New York's ESEA flexibility request. It was dated in February of 2012. When you submitted your request, the very first principle was that you were going to adopt college and career ready standards. You had two options to do so. The first option, which New York took, was to sign the memorandum adopting the Common Core state standards, the one that Achieve was marketing. If you did that, that was the only requirement you had to meet. If you picked option B, your colleges would have to come together, create the standards for your state, but then the colleges would have to certify that the children would meet the standards, and if they met the standards, 100% of them would be able to enter college with no need for remediation. Isn't that 100% proficiency? So if the state adopted a Common Core, the 100% proficiency requirement disappeared. If the state adopted its own standards, the 100% proficiency requirement remained, which meant you were having to prove 100% proficiency to get a waiver from 100% proficiency. It is no wonder that 46 states picked option A. New York said, we took option A, and now we're going to make sure that all of our teachers comply. So all the children will have to pass the test, and teacher evaluation will be based on that. The teachers complained, and so a deal was struck saying that, okay, 60% of teacher evaluation will be based on observation. What is the teacher doing in the classroom? Only 40% of the teacher evaluation will be based on the students passing the test, unless the students don't pass the test. And if the students don't pass the test, then the teachers cannot get an evaluation of effective. That means 100% of the evaluation is based on the students passing the test. Now, this wasn't just the math teachers. Every teacher in the school was evaluated this way, which would lead a reasonable person to wonder why the music teacher or the art teacher would, or the Spanish teacher would be evaluated based on how well students do on a math test. It was to make the assessments all important for everyone, which meant that all instruction would move to the Common Core state standards. In order to implement that, New York brought in experts to look at your standards and then how do we need to shift instructions so that we're actually doing the Common Core state standards. The literacy shifts said we're going to have close and thoughtful reading of the text and evidence-based treatment of what's read. We need to remember those words, close and thoughtful reading of the text, because as we move through, we'll see what that means. And the math said we're going to have intense focus on fewer math topics. Let's look at math first. The New York